See, a little preamble before I move on. This course is about linear transformations on vector spaces. Okay. Now, concrete realizations of linear transformations on vector spaces are matrices. That explains why this indulgence on matrices. Okay. For so many lectures, we'll have another 2 lectures, probably including today's lecture, on matrices, elementary row operations, properties, etc. Okay. Today, I would like to look at certain qualitative aspects of the elementary row operations, row equivalence, row reduced echelon form, etc. Okay, but before that, I'll recollect what we discussed last time. Okay, towards the end of last lecture, I remember having discussed this problem. R is a row reduced echelon form. Okay, so this is to make a quick reminder. R is a row reduced echelon matrix. I am writing down the expanded form of Rx equal to 0. Okay. I was writing down the expanded form of Rx equal to 0. What I know is that small r is the number of non-zero rows of capital R. Okay, this is my notation. So let us look at this equation Rx equal to 0. I will have something like this. R is a row reduced echelon form. So there are certain zeros. I have the first non-zero entry, okay, that is 1, and then certain other entries. Then the second row will be 0, etc. Let us say up to here, and then a 1 here, etc., etc. I have zeros here, 1 somewhere here, etc. Okay, so this is the first R rows. Let me write, this is first R rows. Let me write on the left. R non-zero rows of capital R. R non-zero rows of capital R, that corresponds to this. The rest of the rows are 0. Okay, this is my R. M minus R, totally there are M equations and N unknowns. M minus R, 0 rows. That is the last part. Okay. Now, this R into X is equal to 0. So, I will do matrix multiplication. That into X, X1, X2, etc. I will call this some X star. This is another X star, etc. This is Xn. This is the 0 vector. Okay. I am already assuming you know matrix multiplication, but in any case, we will review it a little later. So, what does matrix multiplication tell us? The right hand side vector 0, the first 0, the right hand side number, this 0 is the dot product of this row with this column. Okay. Now, this 1 appears in the column number C1. This corresponds to certain X. I am calling that XC1. This is column C1. This 1 appears in column C2. This corresponds to certain other unknown. I am calling that XC2, etc. So, I have what I have done is to effect a relabeling of the unknowns as those corresponding to the leading non-zero entry of the non-zero rows of R. Those are XC1, XC2, etc., XCR. The other unknowns I am calling them V1, V2, etc., Vn minus R. I am just relabeling them for the purpose that I will write down the R equations coming out of this homogeneous system, and then it gives us a qualitative information. So, based on this, what I had written is that let V1, V2, etc., Vn minus R denote the other M minus R, I am sorry, N minus R, denote the other N minus R variables. Okay, means not the ones we have denoted by XC1, XC2, etc., XCR, just to make it a little more precise. Then these R equations can be written using a summation formula. Rx equal to 0 is the same as XC1 plus summation j equals 1 to n minus r alpha 1j vj equals 0. That is, I am now denoting the first row entries after this 1 as alpha 1 c1 plus 1, alpha 1 c1 plus 2, etc. This is alpha 1 c, this is alpha 1 n, etc. That is my notation. This is the first equation. Then second equation is written similarly, alpha 2j vj etc. xcr, the last non-zero row gives me this equation xcr plus summation j equal to 1 to n minus r alpha rj vj equals 0. The last non-zero row gives me this equation. So what this means is that, so if n minus r is positive, then arbitrary values could be assigned to v1 etc. vn minus r and xc1 etc. xcr are determined uniquely for every choice of v1, v2, etc., vn minus r. I will have unique xc1, xc2, etc., xcr coming from this set of r equations. So for every such choice of v1, etc., vn minus r, I get xc1, xc2, etc., xcr. That gives me the set of all solutions. Okay, and we had also observed towards the end of last class that if r is strictly less than n, like what I have assumed here, if r is strictly less than n, then rx equal to 0 has a non-trivial solution, a non-zero, we call it a non-trivial solution. A non-zero solution means at least one coordinate, at least one unknown is not 0, at least one unknown is not a 0. Okay, remember this is important because this is a homogeneous system, we know it is consistent, it always has 0 as a solution. So one is interested in a non-zero solution. So there is a guarantee, if r is less than n, then the homogeneous system has a non-trivial solution. I also left you with a little problem. If r is a square matrix and the small r is equal to n, I asked you the structure of r. So what is the structure of r?
Identity.
Is that clear to all of you? So r is equal to identity of order n, identity matrix of order n. So just for the sake of completeness, I write the identity matrix. Okay, it has only the non-zero entries, the off diagonal entries are 0, the principal diagonal entries are all 1. This is the identity matrix of order n. That is what happens if r is a row. So the only row reduced echelon matrix whose number of non-zero rows equal to the order of the matrix is the identity matrix. Okay, we will need this a little later. Okay. Okay, let us now proceed with today's lecture, a little qualitative information. So in particular, I want to prove 2 or 3 results. Let me start with the first one. I consider a rectangular homogeneous system. Where the number of equations is strictly less than the number of unknowns. A homogeneous system is what I am going to consider. The number of equations strictly less than the number of unknowns. OK. Okay, this is a fundamental result of linear algebra, that a rectangular system of homogeneous linear equations, where the number of equations is strictly less than the number of unknowns, always has a non-trivial solution. Okay. The proof will essentially make use of what we have proved, what we have stated just now. Let R be the road reduced echelon form, echelon matrix, row equivalent to the matrix A. Okay. Standard notation, capital R is a row reduced echelon form of A, that is the row reduced echelon matrix, row equivalent to A. Then the systems Ax equal to 0 and Rx equal to 0, we call them as equivalent systems, that is they have the same set of solutions. Ax equal to 0 and Rx equal to 0 have the same set of solutions. As before, let us keep R as a variable. That is the number of non-zero rows of R. Let R equal the number of non-zero rows of capital R. The number of non-zero rows of R cannot exceed the number of rows of R. So R is less than or equal to M. M is the number of rows. And what is given is that M is less than N as part of the data of the problem. M is less than N. Okay. So R is strictly less than N. By the observation that we made just now, it follows that there is a non-trivial solution. Okay. Hence, Rx equal to 0 has a non-trivial solution. So is x, so is Ax equal to 0, so is the system Ax equal to 0, because a set of solutions of Rx equal to 0 coincides with the set of solutions of Ax equal to 0. Okay. So this is based on the observation that if R is strictly less than N, then Rx equal to 0 has a non-trivial solution, at least one non-trivial solution. Okay. Okay. For the square case, we can do a little better. Square homogeneous system, when does it have a non-zero, non-trivial solution? That will be my next result. I have a square matrix with real entries. Then the system Ax equal to 0 has a non-trivial solution if and only if A is row equivalent to the identity matrix of order N, has 0 as the only solution, has 0 as the only solution if and only if A is row equivalent to I. Okay, this denotes A is row equivalent to I. Identity is the row reduced, we know it is a row reduced echelon matrix. Okay. Okay. So now there are two parts, unlike the first, the previous theorem. There are two parts, if and only if. Let us prove the easy one first. Suppose that A is row equivalent to I, then the systems Ax equal to 0 and Ix equal to 0 by definition have the same set of solutions. Ax equal to 0 and Ix equal to 0 have the same set of solutions. That is, I am applying this fact that we had observed previously, that if R is a row reduced echelon form of A, then Ax equal to 0 and Rx equal to 0 have the same set of solutions. I is a row reduced echelon form of A, so these two systems have the same set of solutions. But Ix equal to 0 has only X as a solution. This implies X equal to 0, okay. That is, Ax equal to 0 has only the trivial solution. Ix equal to 0 implies X equal to 0. So this is the easy part of the proof. The homogeneous system Ax equal to 0 has only 0 as a solution if A is row equivalent to the identity matrix. We need to prove the converse. We next prove the converse. So again, we need to look at the row reduced echelon form of A and then show that this row reduced echelon form is equal to identity. So conversely, suppose that X equal to 0 is the only solution of the system Ax equal to 0. So we will look at Rx equal to 0. Let R be the row reduced echelon matrix, row equivalent to A, and small r is equal to the number of non-zero rows of capital R. Okay, then what we have is that then Rx equal to 0 has X equal to 0 as the only solution. X equal to 0 as the only solution, because Ax equal to 0 has X equal to 0 as the only solution, which means the system Rx equal to 0 does not have a non-trivial solution. Appeal to the previous result. By appealing to the previous result, what follows is that R is greater than or equal to n, okay. So let me write down the state. So Rx equal to 0 has no non-trivial solution. Rx equal to 0 has no non-trivial solution. So R is at least n. Okay. But R is a number of non-zero rows of capital R, it can't exceed n. Number of non-zero rows of R cannot exceed the number of rows of R, and so R is equal to n. That is, I have a row reduced echelon matrix, which a square row reduced echelon matrix with the property that the number of non-zero rows is equal to the order of the matrix. So R is equal to I, as we have observed before. Okay, so what we have shown is that if Ax equal to 0 has X equal to 0 as the only solution, that is, if this homogeneous system of homogeneous square system does not have a non-trivial solution, then the matrix A is row equivalent to the identity matrix. Okay. Okay. So much for the homogeneous case. Let us now move on to the non-homogeneous case, that is when the right hand side is not the 0 vector. Well, let us consider the non-homogeneous case and remember that the essential difference between a homogeneous system and a non-homogeneous system is that a non-homogeneous system need not have a solution, okay. A homogeneous system always has a solution. So this information also should be obtainable when we do the elementary row operations. Ideally, when you do the elementary row operations on a system Ax equal to b, we must also know whether at the end of the algorithm, for instance, whether it can tell us if the system has a solution. Okay. Now that information, if you have a row reduced echelon matrix, is immediate. So that's what I want to illustrate next. So I am considering the non-homogeneous system Ax equal to b. Okay. So let's recall that A is an m cross n matrix, m rows and n columns. X is the unknown vector, x1, x2, etc., xn. B is a requirement vector, b1, b2, etc., bm. I am writing them as column vectors. What I will do now is, I not only have the matrix A, I also have the right hand side vector. So I will form a new matrix, call it A prime. I'll adjoin B as a last column of A prime. So my new matrix A prime is A comma B. I'll apply elementary row operations on this. Then I'll get R prime, a row reduced echelon matrix. Now this R prime is R comma D. Okay, what I do is I apply elementary row operations on A, I get R, and then apply the same set of elementary row operations in the same sequence to the matrix that is a column vector B, and then I get the vector D. Okay, that matrix I am calling that as R prime. Okay, now what is not clear but can be shown is that if you take this matrix as it is and then do the elementary row operations on this, treating it as a single matrix, then you will eventually end up with R comma D. Okay, that is, there are two ways of proceeding. One way is to apply elementary row operations on A to get the row reduced echelon matrix R, apply the same elementary row operations on B, you will get the matrix D, you will get the vector D. That is one way of proceeding. The other way is to take this as a matrix, as a single matrix, apply elementary row operations, write down, you will get it of this form. The first part will be row equivalent to the first part, second part will be row equivalent to the second part. Okay, so this is what we have done. From what we have discussed earlier, you have row equivalence, which means if you look at the system Ax equal to b, I am calling this usually as I. I will also look at Rx equal to d, I am calling that system 2. If R comma D is obtained from A comma B by these elementary row operations, then what I know is that any solution of Ax equal to B is a solution of Rx equal to D, and conversely any solution of Rx equal to D is a solution of Ax equal to B, because elementary row operations correspond to linear combinations of equations of that system. Any equation of system 2 is a linear combination of the equations of system 1, and conversely. Okay, and so we know that this, if this happens, then these two systems have the same solution, which we observed in the homogeneous case. That holds in the non-homogeneous case also. In the non-homogeneous case, what do these equations represent? So I look at the expanded version of this, something like Rx equal to 0 that I had written down in the beginning. Let me write down Rx equal to D. As before, small r is a number of non-zero rows of R. Xc1, Xc2, etc., they correspond to the first leading non-zero entries of the R non-zero rows. V1, V2, etc., Vn minus R, they correspond to the other variables. Then I get the following, Xc1 plus, these are very similar to the previous, the homogeneous case, alpha 1j, Vj. This is now D1, okay, it is 0 earlier. Xc2 plus summation j equals 1 to n minus r alpha 2j vj equals d2, etc. Xcr plus summation j equal to 1 to n minus r alpha rj vj equals dr. There is nothing much in these equations. What happens to the other m minus r equations? What are the other m minus r equations? These m minus r equations in the homogeneous case do not matter. They don't contribute anything. They don't give any, they don't lead to any constraints. They don't give any information. But the last m minus r in the non-homogeneous case, in fact, have the essence of the fact that the system has a solution or does not have a solution. So what are the last m minus r equations in the non-homogeneous case? Remember, on the left I have r. See, I am writing down rx equal to d. Okay, let me just do it again so that it's transparent. R is, there are certain zeros, one here, certain entries here, some zeros, one here, certain other entries here, etc. 0 here, 1, etc. These correspond to the R non-zero rows. The other entries are all 0. This is M minus R. This is R. This into X. That's my D. My D is equal to this. I have written down the first R non-zero equations. What happens to the last equations? The last equations give me 0 times x1 etc xn. So it is just 0. On the right hand side I have d r plus 1. Next equation 0 equals d r plus 2 etc dm. This is what I must have. Now these, I told you, do not appear in the homogeneous case because d is 0 in the homogeneous case. D is 0 in the homogeneous case because b is 0. You have a 0 column, you have a 0 matrix, you do elementary row operations, it will remain 0, there will be no change. So B is 0 in the homogeneous case, so D is 0, so these equations do not figure in the homogeneous case. These things have to be satisfied in order that the system has a solution in the non-homogeneous case. Okay, now that is the condition. What is the condition? That Ax equal to B has a solution. This is the condition. Let me write down. Ax equal to B has a solution if and only if di is 0 for all I greater than r. This is m. For all I greater than r, these numbers must be 0. D r plus 1, d r plus 2, these are numbers constituting the vector d. These must be 0. This is the condition that must be satisfied for the system to have a solution. Again, if these conditions are satisfied, then one will fix arbitrary values to v1, v2, etc., vn minus r, fix, determine the other variables xc1, etc., xcr, and one can write down the set of all solutions. Okay, so this, these are the conditions that are necessary and sufficient for the system Ax equal to B to have a solution. Okay, okay, so let us consolidate by looking out, working out one or two examples, numerical examples. You have any questions? I want to illustrate two examples, one where the system has a solution, one where the system does not have a solution. If you do not have any questions, let me proceed. So I want you to consider Ax equal to B for some vector B, where my matrix A is this 3 minus 1, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1 minus 3, 0. This is my matrix. I would like to verify by using elementary row operations. To verify if this system is consistent. If it is consistent, can I write down all the solutions? Okay, let us do the elementary row operations. We are so familiar now, I do not want to write down what operations I am performing. So I know that A is equivalent to, let us say I interchange these two. So 1 minus 3, 0. 2, 1, 1, 3 minus 1, 2. This is equivalent to 1 minus 3, 0. Minus 2 times this, this is 0. Minus 3, 6 plus 1, 7. This will remain as it is. So please check my calculations. Minus 2 times this plus this. Minus 2, that's 6 plus 1, 7. This will remain as it is. Minus 3 times this is 0. Minus 3, 9. 9 minus 1, 8. minus this remains the same. The next operation is to divide by 7, okay. So maybe I'll do that here itself. 1 minus 3 is 0, 0 1 1 by 7, 0 8 2. That's my next operation, dividing the second row by 7. Then I know this is equivalent to, I'll keep the second row. This entry remains the same, 3 times this is 0, 3 by 7. I should have done it along with B. No problem. I'll just append it. Okay. This is my A comma B, A prime. This will be interchange, interchange of these two, B3, B2, B1. This time I am keeping this as the pivot row, minus 2 times this, minus 2 times this plus this, B2 minus 2 B3, minus 3 times this plus this. Okay, that's equivalent to, do that here. This is fine. Then I divide by 7. I can do one more operation, so that is, I will divide by 8 or 2 is better, 0, 4, 1, I am dividing by 2. I am dividing by 2, this becomes 4, this is 1, 1 by 2 times that. Then yeah, I need to use this as the pivot row. So that is equivalent to, I will do these two simultaneously. The second row I keep it as it is. The first row is 3 times this, this will remain 1, this will remain 0. This is 3 times this, 3 by 7, 3 times this plus this. Tell me if this is fine. 1 by 7, 3 B2 plus B3, minus 6 by 7 plus 7 by 7, that is 1 by 7, 3 times the second row. Okay. Please check the calculations here, and this one will be minus 4 times this plus this, minus 4, 1 minus 4 by 7 is 3 by 7, minus 4 times this plus this. Minus 4 times this plus this. I want a volunteer for that entry. Minus 4 times this plus this. Eight by seven minus 3 by 2. Sixteen minus 21. minus 5 by 14. Do you agree with this? Minus 4 times this plus this. So 1 by 2 b1 remains the same. B2 will be minus 4 by 7 b2. B3 only will change, minus 4 by 7. That makes it 8 by 7. 8 by 7 minus 3 by 2 essentially. That's 16 minus 21, minus 5 by 14 b3. Agreed? Okay. One last step, then I must make this 1 and then reduce this. So this is equivalent to, I divide this by 1 to get 1, 0, 3 by 7, 1 by 7, 3 b2 plus b3, 0, 1, 1 by 7. 1 by 7 b2 minus 2 b3 divide by 7 by 3, divide by 3 by 7, 0, 0, 1. Then this last entry is 7 by 3, 1 by 2 b1 minus 4 by 7 b2 minus 5 by 14 b3. Actually, I can solve the system as it is from here, but I want this row reduced echelon form, so I must do two more operations which will make sure that these two entries are 0. Okay. So let me complete that. Let me do these two operations also, write down the solution. Is it clear even at this stage that the system has a solution for whatever b? Okay, let me proceed. The last row is kept as it is, 0, 0, 1. 7 by 3, etc. Please, I am leaving this. I want to make these two 0, so I am going to leave the other calculations also. Determine those two stars. Okay, lots of fractions involved, so I am going to leave that. Okay, but what is clear is that this system has a solution for all b, because the number of, see what I have done in the last step is keep the last row as it is. Second row I am using this, I am multiplying this by minus 1 by 7, I am adding it, this makes this entry 0, multiply by minus 3 by 7 to add to this, this entry will be 0. There will be appropriate changes in the first two rows, I am leaving them for you to calculate. But what is clear from this example is that the number of
first row.
Yeah, what is clear is that R is equal to 3, the order of the matrix A. Okay. And so you do not have to verify these. Di equal to 0 for this. This is vacuously true. Okay, and so for this system, for this coefficient matrix A, whatever be the right hand side vector B, this will always have a solution. So Ax equal to B has a solution for all right hand side vectors B. Okay, this has a solution for all right hand side vectors B. Okay, please remember that we could make this conclusion based on the fact that these equations are not present. These equations are not present. If these equations are present, then you must verify that these are satisfied, but they are not present here. The number of non-zero rows is 3, the order of A. So I have only D1, D2, D3, there is no D4. Okay, so that is the first example. This always has a solution. Let us look at another example. A, this is my A. This time I have the vector b. Okay, b is this vector. The number of unknowns is 4. The number of equations is 3. Okay, so let's quickly do the elementary row operation. See what happens. So I'm starting now with a prime. Okay, let me do the first operation at once because this entry is 1 for me. Has made matters simple. 1 minus 2, 1, 2. The right hand side vector is 1. Minus this plus this. Okay, that's 0, 3, 2, minus 1, 1. Minus this plus this, 0, 9, minus 6, minus 3, 2. What's going on? This I know is row equivalent to the second row. I'll divide by 3. Okay, that's the next set of operations. This is not yet in the row reduced echelon form, okay, but I can make the last entry 1. Okay, this is still not in the row reduced echelon for the last non-zero row is not this, okay, but I can multiply by minus 1 and then remove this, okay, but this is the final row reduced echelon form, okay, this is the final row reduced echelon form. Now this is my D, my vector D in this problem is 5 by 3, 1 by 3, 1, R is 2, the number of non-zero rows of capital R, which is row equivalent to A. Please remember, not this, this has 3 non-zero rows. Let me confirm, R equal to 2 is equal to the number of non-zero rows of R, which is row equivalent to A, okay, which means I must verify, is this true? Is this true? R is 2, so I must verify that D3 is 0. It's not true. So Ax equal to B has no solution. Is that okay? Number of non-zero rows of capital R, which is row equivalent to A, what we have done here is A prime. Okay, this is what I am calling as A prime right from the beginning. This A prime has 3 non-zero rows. A has only, this A prime is row equivalent to a matrix which has 3 non-zero rows. A is row equivalent to a matrix which has only 2 non-zero rows. When there is a difference of this, that will lead to inconsistency. Okay. So this problem, this system does not have a solution, that is clear. Okay. If I change this B to B1, B2, B3, we can also determine the condition under which the system will have a solution. So I am not going to give the details, I am sure you can see this happening in the previous problem. This system will have a solution for all B which satisfy the extra condition. Can you tell me the extra condition that must be satisfied? So I want the answer in terms of B. I know that D3 must be 0. Okay, you please, I'll leave this as an exercise then. I have something like, let us say R, beta times B1 plus gamma times B2 plus delta times B3 equal to 0. My question is, what are these values, beta, gamma, delta? And why is it that I have written a single equation, not several equations? Okay. With this, I will stop.